So I am here with Debbie, otherwise known as the Sane Progressive on YouTube. She has been my go-to source for election fraud this entire election cycle. And I don't think anybody knows more than her. She's documented it. She's talked about it. She has all the interviews where she talks about really weird things going on. So I am here to have her talk about it on my podcast. Debbie, how's it going?
Oh, very good, Mike. Thank you for having me on. Appreciate it.
Absolutely. And this has been a long time in the making. Many of my viewers have been wanting me to talk to you and have you talk about election fraud specifically, because I think that you are a great resource for that. So I'm super stoked about this. I'm a fan of Debbie, and I know a lot of my viewers are too. So can you just tell me a little bit about election fraud, just generally speaking? I know it's a big topic, but basically, we all know that it's happening. I don't think many people know the extent to which it's happening. And that's something that you've kind of shed some light on your channel. And one thing I really want to ask is, has it been the case that it's been this rampant all along? Is this election unique, or has it just always been screwed up?
No, this election is definitely not unique. I've been interviewing people who have been involved in election fraud, integrity activism for decades now. Richard Sharnin, who is the go-to person, who is the gentleman who monitors the exit polls, and has monitored the exit polls for the past 10 years. He's noticed mass discrepancies in all the elections. Usually from the Republican side, favoring the Republicans over the Democrats. But no, it's not new. John Brakey, who brought the lawsuit in Arizona, he's been working on it for ages. Bev Harris just came out with a groundbreaking report on how the machines actually have a function built into them that whose the sole purpose of this function is to be able to change the election results by fractioning the vote, which means not one vote for one person, but it weights the votes differently. So it turns it into a percentage. So one person's vote could count for a third, another person's vote could count fully. If you want to get into the full details of the fraud that has occurred in this particular election on the Democratic primary side, I just want to give you a resource, electionfraud2016.wordpress.com. And that will give you all the documentation of the election fraud that we have been documenting and collecting evidence on since the beginning of the election back in Iowa, state to
Okay,
state.
great. And honestly, if you haven't yet, go and subscribe to Debbie because nobody's covered election fraud more than her. And this is all based on evidence. We're not conspiratorial. We don't have our tinfoil hats on. We're documenting everything. She has screenshots of counties flipping and taking away. I mean, it's insane. I didn't know how rampant it was until she shed light on it specifically. So I think that what she's doing is great. So can you talk about some of the examples of what's kind of happening?
I can. I actually, because this has been an issue that I've been concerned about and following for a very long time. When I first started volunteering for the Bernie Sanders campaign and went to be a volunteer to train other volunteers in my county, I went to a training with some of his campaign in New Hampshire, and I tried to warn the campaign about this. I did a petition back in January, imploring the campaign to request poll monitors and also to get exit pollsters on the ground so that he would have a basis for evidence if he needed to request hand counts. And it started right off the bat. It started right off the bat in Iowa. There was caucus rigging. We had evidence from C-SPAN on video where Clinton's staff was giving misinformation to Bernie Sanders voters, so to telling them to go home prematurely. They were counting the votes of her supporters that weren't there. There were rampant problems in Iowa. And that went on to the point. It was so obvious and so corrupt that the newspaper, the Des Moines Register, which had endorsed Hillary Clinton, and Hillary Clinton preened about that endorsement. It's a very reputable paper. Their board, their editorial board came out and stated flat out that there needed to be a full investigation due to the corruption, and that it needed to be followed through on. I did another petition at that time to Sanders, begging him to please address any irregularities in real time, because I was very concerned, not just with the caucus rigging in Iowa, but we had another 49 states to go. And my view was, if Clinton did not get a clear message that we were going to go toe to toe for every discrepancy that we saw, it was going to be a green light for cheating for the rest of the election. And it went on in Nevada. We saw the same type of things in Nevada that we saw in Iowa. We saw the same kind of caucus rigging. The Nurses United, who had endorsed Bernie Sanders, I'm sure you've seen them, Mike. They have done a lot of advocacy. They have a bus that's gone around the country. They saw such things in Nevada that they came out nationally and asked for poll monitors to be brought in after what they witnessed in Nevada. And then that's just the caucuses. Which we have seen in other caucuses moving forward. We saw in Nebraska and we saw in Washington, Bernie Sanders winning these caucuses. Like, the room would be full of Bernie Sanders supporters, and then there would be a little corner for Clinton, and they'd bring in these boxes. There'd be boxes of absentee ballots, and they'd dump them on the table, and Bernie Sanders would have won the precinct but these absentee ballots would be going 90% for Hillary Clinton. And then we have the biggest thing that you know, there's so many aspects. We see the exit polls not matching the official results. Now, exit polls, you know, from a reputable agency, usually have a margin of error between 2 to maybe 5% based on the sample size. These exit polls are going 8%, 10%, 15% in error. If you look at Richard Charnin's work, and his blog is linked on the page that I gave you, you know, mathematically, these are, mathematically, that is a huge, huge red flag. Now, the United States, when they look at exit polls, in other nations, like when there's elections in other nations, they look at that those exit polls to make sure they're matching the election results. And if they don't, the United States will flag that as a red flag for possible fraud. But we're seeing that nearly across the board in almost every state with Hillary Clinton. Nobody says a word.
And one thing I wanted to get your opinion on is, you see some things that you don't necessarily have to dive in to understand what's happening. Like in Arizona, they cut the number of polling stations. They did it in heavily populated Latino areas. They did it in Rhode Island. Even though Bernie Sanders won, they still reduced it by 2/3.
Yeah, 66%.
Right. So the thing is that we see this happening, and currently it doesn't really hurt Hillary Clinton, but what her supporters don't understand, what she doesn't understand, is that if it continues this way, it's going to hurt her in November if she is the nominee. So I can't understand why there's no urgency from the Clinton campaign for her supporters to support this. It doesn't make sense to me.
It makes complete sense, dear. She's just going to do the same thing in November. Why do you think, you know, now there's two components, and I want to talk about the voter suppression and the purging of the rolls in a minute. But there's another component to this. There's another component to this that you can just bring with sheer logic. You see Hillary Clinton in New York City, and I've seen her rallies, and they're empty rooms. They're empty rooms. The people do not exist. Now, in Washington Park, it was like 27,000 people, and the NYPD said there were 50,000 people who showed up, but they couldn't fit everybody in. There was another, I think it was a Prospect Park, 30,000 people. This has gone on all around the country. If you look just yesterday in East LA, there was a rally for Hillary Clinton. It was a gymnasium. Empty. It was like a fourth full. There were more protesters outside of the East LA rally saying, "Drop out Hillary," than there were people in that room. And so something tells you something like is wrong when you see tens of thousands of people everywhere Bernie Sanders goes. and Hillary Clinton can't fill a room. That's just sheer logic. And what? And the other thing I want to note here that is so important, you know, Hillary Clinton, I think Bernie Sanders has already won this election. But even if those numbers were accurate, Bernie Sanders is right behind her. She doesn't have the independent vote. She doesn't have Republicans. Republicans will turn out in record numbers just for the privilege of voting against her. And, you know, a lot of Democrats are very distrustful. She has a 59% disapproval rating with the general population, but she just, her aides just informed on the Hill, through the Hill, that they're not going to give Bernie Sanders anything at the convention. They're not going to adopt his platform positions. They are not going to do anything. And so this is a person who's really going to need Bernie Sanders voters, and they're going to need those independent voters. That's 43% of the population. Hillary Clinton is not doing anything to reach out to Bernie Sanders voters. She's flipping us off. Where does she get the luxury of taking that position? The latest poll with her and Trump had them 2 percentage points apart. How does she have the luxury of totally disregarding such a huge block of voters? Something is wrong. Common sense. Common sense.
So let me just get this straight, though. I don't want to put words in your mouth.
Okay.
Are you saying that we shouldn't trust Hillary Clinton? Is that what you're saying?
I know. That's a shocking statement for me to be put forth. No.
And I'm just surprised that her argument, the pitch that she made to us, is I'm winning. That doesn't resonate with you. What's going on?
As far as I'm concerned, this election is a psyop. It's a psyop. It is blatantly being stolen. And it really is a hallmark of how much control, you know, the media has had, and that we don't have independent alternative media. Because this is not conspiracy theory. There is a lot of objective evidence. I would implore everybody to go to the blog. The level of evidence, and we didn't even get into talking about the purged voter rolls. You know, in Arizona, hundreds of thousands of people were purged off the voter rolls. And what a coinkydink. They all seem to be Bernie Sanders supporters. It happened in New York. 126,000 people purged off the voter rolls in Brooklyn, in Bernie Sanders' hometown. We have reports in California that it's happening again. And we've had reports all over the country of this happening. And, you know, it's, and then what is the other one? There's a voter suppression as well. The closing the precincts, the long lines, and it's a mess. It's a mess.
It really is. And it's frustrating because we're supposed to be like the beacon of hope for other countries around the world, who we're supposed to be like that shining example of democracy. And you have so much problems going on and effectively nothing is being done about it. You have independent media sites like you and me who are covering it. But the problem is that we're small. Like, we don't have the reach that the mainstream media has. So if they don't report it, then very little people know about it. And that's what's frustrating.
It is amazing that we have had the effect we have had even with these small alternative media channels, because the media is starting to pay attention. In the past few weeks, there have been, in response to us bringing this to light on social media, we've had Raw Story, Washington Post, I think Salon, put out articles with the usual conspiracy theory smear. Our group, which documents election fraud over on Facebook, documenting Democratic primary election fraud 2016, we have a project called Screenshot the Vote. And Screenshot the Vote is something I started back in Massachusetts. I live in Massachusetts. And I noticed when I was watching the election results come in live, because it's my state, so I'm refreshing and I'm refreshing and I'm refreshing, and I started to see really weird things. One of the things I noticed was one of the precincts out in the eastern part of the state, it was 100% reporting, and there were 0 votes for Bernie Sanders, and there was 100% votes for Hillary Clinton. And then I was watching the screenshots come in, and I was watching, and all of a sudden, Hillary Clinton's votes jumped way up, which can happen when a precinct comes in. They change. It's part of the deal. But when I looked and actually tried to find where those votes came in, you know, did it come in from Boston? I totaled all the individual precincts and the votes didn't exist. It's like when you totaled them, they were reporting like 10,000 extra votes for Clinton that didn't exist in the total. And so what our group started to do was we started screenshotting the vote results as they came in real time. And we have noticed crazy discrepancies. We watch Bernie Sanders' vote totals go down. We see more than 100% of precincts reporting. We see Hillary Clinton all of a sudden making up these huge gains in the last 10%, things that are really mathematically not even possible if you actually follow the totals as they come in. And we've done this ever since Michigan. Our group has done this, and we have actually documented almost every single state. But we had shared a screenshot where we showed, it was just one of the screenshots, we have hundreds of these, but it was one screenshot where we had shown Bernie Sanders' votes had decreased by 4,000. At 18%, he had 6,000, and I think at 39%, he had 2,000. So it was one of the examples. And the Washington Post took that one screenshot and said that we were conspiracy theorists, and they put up an argument about how they don't even have the vote totals come in, and they didn't address any of our concerns. And they really, it was very poorly written, and it was the kind of thing that you smear people with. And you know what is really the most disturbing thing about this, Mike, is that all we are asking for is an honest accounting of the votes. We want some hand counts. And we want our concerns, which are legitimate, to be addressed. And when the media has got to smear us as conspiracy theorists, voters who are concerned about the integrity of our election system, instead of us taking us seriously, they make fun of us. And I think that is a huge red flag for people who do not want to address what's really going on.
Right. And if there's anything that I can attest to, and I'm sure you can as well, is that everything that is negative towards Hillary Clinton, it's a conspiracy theory. Case in point, her FBI investigation, she's literally under investigation for criminal charges, potentially. Who knows? But that's a conspiracy theory. We're not allowed to talk about it. It's based on the right wing. It's just the smear from them. So it's frustrating that no matter what we do, if we actually try to be objective and gather the facts, we're conspiratorial. You can't win. You just can't win.
Well, the media hasn't been incredibly dishonest about how they have reported Hillary Clinton's story. They constantly, anything with Hillary Clinton, it is always a Republican witch hunt. They don't talk about the story in terms of the facts of the story. They talk about making Hillary Clinton a victim instead of responsible for her actions as Secretary of State. And because of that, nobody even really understands the basics of the Hillary Clinton email scandal. Have you talked a lot about that on your show?
I did one video where I actually just went in what would happen if she was indicted. And my whole, this is speculative, of course, is my contention is that I think she's probably, if she is indicted, which who knows what's going to happen at this point, it would be Joe Biden that the party pushes us towards, not Bernie Sanders. And so because of that, I was kind of preparing my viewers that if something does go down, we're going to have to be ready. We have to be get ready to protest, get ready to put a lot of pressure on the DNC, because they're not going to just give us Bernie Sanders that easily. So that's about the extent to which I've covered it. But there's so much details in this scandal and whatnot that you can talk about it for hours. It's amazing.
Yeah, I think there is so much confusion for people not even understanding what the story actually is, because the media has obfuscated it so much to even really understand that it even is an issue. And it should be a huge issue. If anybody other than Hillary Clinton took the actions that Hillary Clinton did in creating a private server, unencrypted, outside the knowledge of the government, subverted Freedom of Information Act, subverted government oversight, totally unencrypted, they would be already indicted and probably serving jail time. It's really, you know, what they say that Hillary Clinton didn't do anything wrong. The very action of creating that server and taking that action was a deliberate subversion. And Freedom of Information Act is incredibly important because that is how we are able to practice oversight as citizens. She subverted that. So, and people have tried to assert that it's not a criminal investigation. The FBI does not conduct security reviews. It is a criminal investigation. There have been dozens of FBI agents put on this case. And Hillary Clinton has really tried to hide and say, oh, well, I didn't know that there would be any classified information going through my unencrypted server, my sole server for housing my email. She didn't use another server. This is where everything went through. I didn't know there'd be any classified information on that. How could I know that? And, you know, she says it wasn't labeled. Two big points on that. First of all, it is not the label that makes something classified. It is the content. So it does not matter. For her to put that argument forward is ludicrous. It doesn't matter. It matters that the information in it is classified. As Secretary of the United States, she had the duty to understand what that information meant. She had to sign a release to say that she would be able to identify it. She received training so that she, you know, would be able to identify it. And second point, Hillary Clinton says it wasn't classified. Hillary Clinton generated a large portion of the material that was classified, and it was she who didn't mark it. So not only did she mishandle the information, she is the one who didn't mark the information that became retroactively classified. So there's so much confusion around this story, and most people don't even know those basic points. They think she was just confused, there was no ill intent. And the big thing with it is, why did Hillary Clinton do that? And people do not know that there is two investigations going on right now. We will have probably an answer about the indictment around the private use of a private server. But the much bigger story is the reason why she did it. And that is the Clinton Foundation was receiving, while Hillary Clinton was Secretary of State, she was receiving through the Clinton Foundation millions of dollars, tens of millions of dollars from corporations and authoritarian regimes who ended up receiving through her State Department either weapons deals or deals through the Trans-Pacific Partnership that resulted in a lot of profitability and power for the people who were giving her money to the foundation at that time. And there is a conflict of interest and there is bribery involved. So that is actually the bigger scandal, and very few people understand that's going to continue even if Hillary Clinton is the general nominee.
And that is terrifying, and it should be terrifying for anyone who keeps pushing the narrative that if you don't want Trump to be in office, you should be afraid of that. So yeah, I'm glad that you laid that out. Thank you for that. So what we're going to do now is we're going to switch and go over to Debbie's channel so that way we can finish the rest of this conversation there. Debbie, before we go, can you tell my subscribers where they can find you and subscribe to you?
You can find me over on YouTube at Sane Progressive, www.youtube.com/Sane Progressive. You can also find me on Facebook. I encourage everybody to go on the Facebook page because I give a lot more information there. And you can join me on Twitter as well.
All right. Well, there you have it. Ladies and gentlemen, if you haven't done it, please subscribe to Debbie. You're missing out. Again, she's one of my favorite YouTube commentators, and she's blowing up just past 10,000. Congrats on that, by the way. And she's only going to get bigger from here. So we will pick this up over at Sane Progressive channel. Hopefully you guys will follow us there.